Episode 74, 5 to 1, Crimes to Commit. You would rather go pee in our backyard than walk to your bathroom, even if it's right there.
Yeah. Sometimes when the dogs go outside, I also go outside.
Hey, Jake, wanna go outside?
Hello and welcome to this week's episode of 5 to 1. 5 to 1 is all about the countdown from our panel of experts on a different topic each episode. Today, we are featuring the best crimes to commit in our style of counting down from
5 to 1.
Dude, Michael Jackson might be a deplorable human being.
I was just about to say, like, why'd you choose this?
This song is so good, though. Yeah. I mean, this is Smooth Criminal, so yeah. It fit the theme. His music, though.
And his character. Mean,
no, his character is horrible. But his music, though, is so good.
Isn't that debatable?
I don't think there's much debate anymore, especially after the HBO special came out last year. But his music is so good. This song.
Like, I wasn't alive when his music hit, like, the mainstream. Yeah. Like, how big was he?
Oh, he's gigantic. He was the biggest pop star in the world by far during the 80s. I mean, his nickname was the King of Pop. Elvis Presley was the king of rock and roll, and then Michael Jackson was the king of pop.
Who would you say was bigger between both?
It's a good question. I wasn't alive for the Elvis craze. I mean, he, from everything I've heard, was just as gigantic, but it was way before my time. I was alive. I lived through the Michael Jackson craze, and he was huge, huge. I mean, there was no bigger star in the world. I would say not just music star, but period, during that time, yeah. Until Michael Jordan.
That's true.
Came along, and he was probably a bigger star than Michael Jackson. I don't know. It's hard to compare hard to compare sports versus music, but they're both huge. Oh, that Michael Jordan special. Have you guys seen the previews for this? It's coming out. I think it's on Sunday. It's like a 20-hour documentary on Michael Jordan's last season with the Bulls.
Whoa.
I know. I can't wait to watch
20 hours?
It. Yes.
Are you going to watch it?
Yeah, I'm going to watch the whole thing. I'm really excited for it. Michael Jordan was something else. I mean, he was... I think there are only two athletes you can compare to Michael Jordan to the stature that he has within his sport, and it's Babe Ruth and Muhammad Ali and Michael Jordan, and that's it. That's your top three pantheon. So
Michael Jordan is the biggest out of those, for sure.
You think so? You think he's bigger than Babe Ruth?
Yes. Yeah.
I mean, maybe because he's more recent. Babe Ruth was in the 1920s and 30s was probably just as big, but it was a long time ago. Anyway, I've said this for a few episodes now, just in case you've missed them. We are on Spotify, so go check us out there if you like. I wanted to also... point out that I get a lot of people that ask me, like, I see you have this podcast and I want to listen. How do I listen? And there are people here that maybe people tell me, like, I listen on your Facebook page because that's where you post the link, which I forget to do like 80% of the time. that's one way you can watch, but it's not the best way. The best repository for podcasts in general, not just ours, is iTunes. Basically, every podcast app that any phone uses, whether it's an iPhone or an Android, pulls from the iTunes library. So you can go right to iTunes. You can use any podcast app. Just search for 5 to 1. You can also listen on Facebook. You can listen on Google Play. You can follow us on our Facebook page. Or you go directly to our website, 5to1podcast.com. So there's lots of ways to listen. I would recommend getting your favorite podcast app. There's one that comes standard on iPhones. I don't know about Androids. I know there's lots of apps out there that people use. Subscribe to our podcast there. It'll automatically download when we have a new episode and be ready for you. So that's the best way to do that. I wanted to get that out of the way since I have had people asking. We're kind of in the middle of a run of recordings that have diverted from the typical pop culture topics that we revolve around. We mostly do music and movies and TV shows. It's kind of nice to do things that are more personality revealing as opposed to our opinions on pop culture.
Yep.
And tonight's show is going to be that way. How deviant are we, really? Am I raising two criminal masterminds? I don't know. I guess we will find out during this episode. But before we get much further, we should probably introduce our panel of crime experts. I'm Chris, and I'm joined by my two criminally handsome sons.
Cade Moore.
That's my 15-year-old.
Jet Maximus Keith Moore.
That's my 13-year-old, and we are
5 to 1.
All right. So, I skipped this last time. I'll do...
Feedback!
We didn't do that last time.
I did. I totally skipped it last time, and that was kind of intentional because I didn't ever share the episode.
Oh,
I'm sure there was some feedback. Like, I always get feedback from our like very loyal crew of listeners, Casey, Nick, Evan, Dave, and Darren, and all them. But it had been such a long time that I didn't want to search my
text. That was impressive how you said all their names that quickly.
They're my best friends.
I mean, like off the top of your head, like in like you made it sound good, I guess. Like if they were in a song lyric, like in a line, I feel like that's exactly how their names would go.
It's because I'm an excellent freestyler.
Can you do it again? Exactly how you said it before?
I don't remember how I said it before. No. Longtime listener Casey King, speaking of, said that we are the best part of his quarantine. I love that. That was really nice.
Thank you.
We also had some feedback about not including self-love as a quarantine activity. And this is a family show, so we didn't really talk about that. There were some listener votes for that activity. Jed's looking at me like, what the heck are you talking about? maybe one of our listeners pointed out that maybe the lots of showers might have been a reference to that.
Just, I'm confused.
Stay confused then. I'm happy that you're confused. Lastly, Jed, the light bulb just went off. Jed's face.
Okay, I got it.
The light bulb just went off. Lastly, we changed the format of the show a while ago to have things like the fun fact of the week and Jet's pun of the week. Jet's still laughing at the end because some of our younger listeners had indicated they skip all the intro stuff anyways to get right to the list. I think one of you told me that, like your friends listen, they're like, oh, we skip all this front stuff anyways. Yeah. We just go right to the list. And I think some of the younger listeners do that. However, our longest and most faithful listeners told me on a Zoom call a few nights ago that they preferred it the old way when we had all that stuff up front before we got to our list. And I'm leaning towards switching it back because that's our crew, man. They've been with us the whole time.
I mean, why don't we go half before list,
so
other
what,
half
what
after.
I've done now is I do feedback up front because it's talking about the last episode. And then I go into our lists, and then we do listener choices because it makes sense to have that like right after.
Yeah.
And then I do the extra stuff, which is the fun fact of the week and Jet's pun of the week. So it kind of made sense to me to have it flow that way, but I don't know. We can switch it back. The Zoom call, they did tell me they liked having Jet's pun as the at the end. It's like a good way to like go out. A lot of people look forward to your really awkward puns of the week. So I don't know.
Listener choices make sense. It's after
though. Yeah. Well, what I would like to do is kind of crowdsource this, and if the listeners out there get into contact with me and let me know what format do you think works best? What do you like? What would you like to hear in what order? If you don't like any of the segments, let me know. If you think there's something else we could be doing, let me know. I'd appreciate that because we've kind of been sticking with this format that we have now for a while. We're going to do it for this episode too, but I'd like to know what our listeners like best. All right, so moving on to our list. Did you guys have any rules?
I did like top five crimes I'm most likely going to commit.
That's what.
So you're most likely going to commit these crimes like at some point in your life if you haven't already?
Not like coolest crimes, but ones that like I might... Like, if I was going to commit a crime, I would do these.
That's what I did. Like, if I were to commit a crime, I would do one of these.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
I'll be honest. I didn't put a whole lot of time into my list as far as, like, thinking things through. I usually make a really long list and think about it a lot and rank them and eliminate things. This one I kind of did on the fly, but I did have one general rule. And while I don't think that any crime is truly self-contained within itself... I did have it in the back of my mind that I wouldn't want to commit a crime that hurts somebody else directly or personally.
I mean, most of mine don't hurt anything like that, except like major corporations and stuff like that. But
yeah, yeah. And I don't know if it was a rule that I had, but it was something I was definitely cognizant of while I was considering my choices. I was like, I don't really like, for example, I had stealing art, like a famous piece of art, I think would be like a really cool thing to do. But if I was stealing it from somebody's private residence, that's something they probably really care about and spend a lot of time trying to acquire.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't want to hurt somebody like that. Like, maybe it's really important to them. And even, like, stealing from the Louvre, that means tons of people can't go see the Mona Lisa. Yeah. You know what I mean? So, I thought about... that was in the back of my mind. I wouldn't want to hurt people in any of these crimes. That being said, every crime has the potential to hurt somebody in some way, even if it's indirectly. But just something...
Don't forget to clarify, don't try any of this at home.
Yes, much like going to RedTube to get free YouTube Red.
And by the way, it does work. They patched it. It wasn't working before. It is working now.
All right. Let's get onto our list. We're already what? Almost 10 minutes in, so we should probably start. Okay, we'll start with you. What's your
number five?
Vandalism.
Okay, well, what would you vandalize? And
I've had some thought about this. Some major thought. I want to paint like a really inappropriate picture on a really big building.
Okay. Well, by inappropriate, do you mean a penis?
Yeah.
Okay. And what building?
Like, I don't know. What's like the most famous building?
I don't know. I mean, there's lots of famous buildings. You could do the Sears Tower in Chicago. It's really tall.
Yeah. Just something to where everyone in the whole city can see something that they really don't want to see.
Yeah. Like the Empire State Building?
Yeah. You know who I want to draw? The guy that's been surfing
around the internet. Oh, what's his name? I know what you're talking about.
I don't know his name.
Several of my friends texted it to me.
Yeah, me too. He's everywhere, all over the internet. I don't know his name.
Poor dude. But
what I liked about... I even looked up who this guy was. He was a adult film star who passed away within the last 10 years or so.
R.I.P.
Yeah, and that picture has been photoshopped to enlarge certain parts.
Oh, I was like, there's no way.
Yeah.
I mean, everyone, that's the meme about it. It's like people question.
So is like, it actually what? Like small?
I don't know, but it's not that big. What I like, my favorite part about this meme is that it coincided with the coronavirus outbreak. And so that there were all these like crossovers between that meme and the coronavirus memes. Yeah. Like,
those came at the perfect time.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So you would spray paint that dude on a giant building somewhere.
Yeah. And like, I'm going to do it like, when's like the time least people are out? Like 2 in the morning, 2:33 in the morning.
Yeah.
When like no one's up yet. Only like the janitor's working, whatever.
What do you like?
Everyone to wake up and like as they're driving down like the road, they're going to see it like everyone all at once.
Right.
And it's not like something you can take down very easily. Like that's like my big thing for vandalism.
Would you like
the small things for vandalism are nice too.
Would you like smash car doors or something?
No. See, that's hurting people's stuff. I wouldn't do that.
That's a pain to have to go get your windshield fixed.
I know what you're thinking of, Fight Club.
Yes.
Yeah. I know what scene you're thinking of, but I wouldn't want to do that because I would... I mean, imagine if that was your car out front and you woke up one day and like your mirrors were destroyed and your car was like, what the heck? What did I do to you? You know?
Yeah, that's true. I think
doing stuff to buildings is fine.
Yeah. I mean, it does hurt people in a sense because it's going to be, but I know what you're saying. It's indirect though.
That's indirect.
What I was saying up front. None of these crimes are really innocent. They all hurt somebody in some way because somebody's going to have to pay for that, right? It's not going to be.
And then clean it.
And clean it. Yeah. I mean, it's work for people. So it affects people. I have vandalized in my lifetime before.
I have too.
I bet mine was worse than yours.
What'd you do?
Are you going to say it?
Yeah, sure. I'll fess up. When I was in high school, I went to Plano Senior High, and we had a rivalry with Plano East Senior High, PESH, as I like to call it.
I like where the story's going already.
And a good friend of mine, who I will not incriminate because he did not voluntarily give me permission to do so.
Let's call him John Doe.
John Doe. A good friend of mine, had the idea to go spray paint their high school before the big Plano versus Plano.
Their high school?
What did you spray paint? Like
all over the school, we spray painted how much PESH sucks and how Plano rules, like all over their school.
That's really funny.
At like 2 in the morning. And I worked at a grocery store, so I was underage. But I wasn't allowed to even buy spray paint because you have to be 18. But I got the hookup through one of my cashier
co-workers.
Friends. Yeah. And we went in the middle of the night and we parked about half a mile away. So that way nobody saw our cars and we wore dark clothes and we trekked it to the school and spray painted all over.
Did you feel guilty after?
It was on the news the next day.
Really?
Yeah.
That's pretty cool. Wow. That's pretty cool. Did people like at your school know that you did it?
No, we never told anyone.
You never told anyone?
No. We did not want to get in trouble. No, the retaliation was bad because I think they might have either stole the ducks from our pond or they killed one or something.
See, spray painting is one thing.
I know.
Killing a duck is like...
It's horrible.
Yeah, like why?
It's awful. I don't know if that was true. It was a rumor that was floating around.
Okay, what did you do?
I'm legally advised not to disclose what I did. I'm just kidding.
Fair enough.
I'm just kidding.
All I've done but is like draw penises on desks.
You know how people draw on the inside of stalls?
What movie is that where the dude draws penises like all over his papers?
Oh, that's Superbad.
Is it Superbad? Okay.
Yeah, it's like an addiction funny. And like as like a little kid and like a girl sees him.
Yes. That's so funny. All right, go ahead, Kay. Sorry.
You know like how people like draw in stalls and stuff like that? There's like a famous stall. It's like the handicap stall at the very end. You know, like the best one to go to?
Yeah.
It's in upstairs like G Hall or something like that.
Uh-huh.
I don't know. But there's a whole conversation going on where people are scratching into it. The first one's, it's like, it starts off, someone wrote, how is your poop going? And then, like, the conversation goes down a couple feet. People keep writing, like, and starting conversations.
About
like,
how their poop's going? Or is it
no,
just, like, one flow?
No, it branched off from how's your poop going to dude, I just got this Fortnite win or something, like,
yeah,
got the new COD or whatever. But
Call of Duty.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think that's cool.
Yeah.
That's really cool. Just like,
it's scratching
all the way down.
It's almost like a chronicle of high school students.
And makes me wonder if the two people just keep going back and forth and continue this conversation, or it's other people.
I'm sure other people have.
It'd be kind of weird if it was just the two people keep writing to each other.
That's great. That's really cool. All right, cool. So vandalism is yours. Number five.
Vandalism's fun.
All right, Jet, what's
mine
your number
is
five?
Insurance fraud.
Okay, can you elaborate? I already love this answer. Let me hear why.
I could get a lot of money, right?
Potentially. I don't know. I don't know much about insurance fraud. Are you saying like you would fake an injury or something?
I would like fake an injury or a car crash.
Okay. So the insurance company would cut you a check for some amount because of you committed a fraud saying that something happened that didn't happen.
I feel like you're pretty likely to get away with this one. I mean, more than the other ones.
I don't know. I mean, these insurance companies are cutthroat. I think they're pretty thorough. They deny people that really are hurt, you know?
Really?
Yeah.
I mean, it just seems like, I mean, it's funny watching videos online of people trying to get the check for it.
Yeah.
Like, that guy's, like, on a bicycle, and he, like, purposely, like, walks backwards into a car and, like, falls on top of the car.
Yeah. When I think of insurance companies, I think of that scene from The Incredibles when the dad, at the beginning of the movie, worked for an insurance company, and this old lady's calling in, and, like, he's supposed to tell her to deny her claim, but instead, he's, like, subtly giving her hints about what she could do and who to talk to and what form to fill out to, like, get the money.
Yeah.
Because he can't be a hero anymore, but in this little small way, he can still help people. Yeah. That's what I think of when I think of insurance companies. You know,
what's the movie where the guy is like driving his car and like people are skating and they like do a trick or whatever and they land on the car and then the guy like ends up joining them? And
I don't know what you're talking about.
What's the movie? I can't remember.
How is this related though?
They purposely like, it's the same thing. They're like riding skateboards, and like every time a car drives by, they're trying to do a trick or whatever.
Yeah.
And then they like land on the car, and then they act like they broke like a bone or something like that.
I see. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hmm. I don't know what that is though. Hmm.
Forgot what movie it was.
All right, Jed, are you done with your insurance fraud?
Yes.
Okay. My number five, which I just talked about, is stealing art, but not really art. I put something valuable. And I put this because the idea gets romanticized in movies like Entrapment and The Thomas Crown Affair. And it makes for interesting stories. Like, I like the idea of having to set up this elaborate and detailed plan to break into some, like, high-security place and remove, whether it's art or whatever valuable is, without getting caught or without damaging it. And it's also cool to think about how you could do that. Like the Louvre, for example, is like the Mona Lisa. Just take that as an example. It would be impossible, basically, to steal that with the security. But to come up with a plan and, like, implement it and have it work would be really cool. For me, to make it more personal, instead of the Mona Lisa, I'd go for something like from the Baseball Hall of Fame in Cooperstown, and I looked up some things that were in there today. Jet, how cool would it be if we broke into the Baseball Hall of Fame and stole Ricky Henderson's gloves he wore when he broke the stolen base record in 1991?
That'd be insane.
That'd be so cool, right? I saw a picture of it today. I'm like, oh, gosh, I want those.
I want it.
And then also they had a baseball that Babe Ruth hit, a home run, that was – they didn't measure baseball distances back then, but it was over 500 feet. That he walloped this ball, which is crazy for like back then and the technology they had, the baseball bats they had, and the baseballs, like none of it is the same as it is now. Babe Ruth was just a monster.
Big dude.
He was kind of like, yeah, he was a big dude. And if you look at him in his later career, he looked pudgy.
Yeah.
And he was. In his youth, he wasn't. He was just muscular. Like most people don't even see those pictures of him.
Yeah, I usually see when he just looks like, I don't know.
But even when he was just muscular and stocky, he had kind of a round face, you know? And so he just always looked like that, you know? But then as he got older, he was definitely pudgier, but could still hit the crap out of a baseball.
My number four is theft.
Okay, well, go on, because I'm done with my number five.
I mean, everyone's stolen something before, whether it be shoplifting or little things. And, like, you feel guilty about it, but in the moment, it's a really good feeling.
Yeah, there's, like, a thrill or a high that comes with it. Yeah,
like a adrenaline rush.
I remember back in first grade.
You took something?
This kid I really didn't like.
I remember this.
I took his book and I threw it in the trash. And then he looked for the book like 10 minutes and he found it in the trash. He's like, why did I throw it in the trash? And I literally said, that's funny. And then like after, I took the books back and brought them to my house.
I remember because we found it in your backpack.
And, like that moment, I'm like, this is amazing. Like, I'm like a criminal mastermind, and somehow I got caught. Like,
yeah, why did your parents open your backpack? You got caught.
But how? Like,
because his name was in it.
I'm like, oh, well, he gave them to me.
There was a book in your bag that I knew wasn't yours, and I opened it, and somebody else's name was in it. I'm like, Jet, why do you have this book with some other kid's name in it?
Do you remember what I said?
You said that you took it from him, and I said, Jet, take it back to him.
Yeah, I took it back to him. I'm like, yeah, I stole your books, man. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Well, it's good that you owned up to it. Everybody makes mistakes. You know, you got caught up in the, you know, the anger that you felt towards him, and you wanted to do something, right? And you did, but you owned up to it. You took it back to him.
I've also stolen lots of pencils, like in class, from other people when they're not looking.
Oh, yeah, you do those things, like, when everyone's up in their seat, you like walk by, like snatch and put in your pocket real quick, and then you act like, and they're like, where's my pencil? And you like do the thing, like look under the desk, like, I don't know. Like when you're using their pencil. I do that all the time.
Yeah, I've done that a lot.
I never have a pencil.
So you picked theft as your number four. If you could steal something, what would you steal?
I mean, I don't really want to steal something for how much it's worth.
Yeah.
I want to steal something that's loved by everyone.
Okay.
That people like everyone, like, I don't know how to explain it. Something that people would be like, what, that got stolen?
Yeah.
Not for like how much it's worth. Like, I don't like what's the diamond, like the biggest diamond in the world?
The Hope Diamond.
Yeah. Like, I wouldn't want to steal that. It's just a diamond. I don't care.
Yeah.
But if you steal something that means a lot to a lot of people, I feel like that'd be really funny.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I wouldn't destroy or anything. I don't know. I might leave it like randomly somewhere.
Like leave it somewhere hidden and leave clues and
yeah, and like lead people, to it. Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be
leave, cool. Like a treasure hunt. But I don't know what I would like steal though.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. One item that means a lot to a lot of people.
Yeah.
I don't know. But I have stolen like little stuff here and there. Not like shoplifting.
Yeah.
This year, I mean, it's just a lot of pencils. I stole a stapler from my teacher once. She really gets annoyed about her staplers, and she really got me mad one day, and I just took it.
Hope she listens to this.
I really hope she does too. She's going to know who it is.
You have a history of talking about teachers you don't like on our podcast. You've done it like every...
She really got me heated in the moment. She's always mad about her staplers. Like, she's mad about people breaking them or jamming them or whatever. I can't even imagine her reaction.
By the way, we love all the teachers out there. This is not a teacher-hating podcast.
Yeah, no. Nothing against you, but I took your stapler.
Okay. All right.
I have a friend who... I'm not going to mention his name because I don't want him... You know,
you don't
want
to incriminate him. Sure.
Yeah, but he's told me that he loves stealing things. Like he really gets high off of it. Like he loves stealing things, but it's just little things. And he takes screws out of his teacher's desk after school, and so like her desk is always like wobbling and her chair is always wobbling.
Uh-huh.
And I was in eighth grade and he was in seventh grade, and I was leaving school, and I turned and I see him standing on a desk taking the clock off the wall and putting it in his backpack. And I talked to him after, and I was like, dude, why'd you steal a clock? He goes, I really don't know why. I just love doing it.
Wow.
He says he's planning something big. I don't know what it is. I've also taken several laptop cart keys.
Okay.
What was the point of that one?
Again, it's something my teachers really cherish, and they don't like, because you have to unlock it with a key. So I usually just take the key, and I can't imagine how mad they are. They're like, where's the key to my laptop cart? How am I going to teach my class today with no laptop?
This year, I took 3 gum packets. Like, he was passing out gum, and while he was doing it, I took like the 3 off the desk, and when he turned around to give more, like, they were just gone. And he was like,
wait, who? Looking a teacher around. Or a student?
The teacher. He was like passing out free gum. And like he was like, where is it?
So
like,
teacher's doing something nice by passing out gum, and you took all of it so he couldn't continue passing
out. Oh yeah, gum. And it was also free gum.
Okay.
It was gonna give it out anyway,
I think after this episode I'm gonna need to talk to you guys about stealing things.
Don't worry, I haven't done anything in a long time.
Parenting lesson here. All right, Jet, what's your number 4?
Boating while drunk.
What?
Is this a crime?
Yes.
Well, yes, it's considered
I don't want to drive while drunk because I could hurt someone. But boating while drunk, I don't see any harm in that.
I think you could still hurt someone.
Yeah, definitely.
Or hurt yourself.
Yeah. I think it could be really fun. Like
there was a baseball player who died a year or two ago from a boating accident while he was drunk. A famous one. I'm trying to remember his name. He was a pitcher for the Marlins. Oh, that's good. It's right on the tip of my tongue. Yeah, he was in a boating accident, and
I think I kind of remember this.
He died along with everybody else that was in his boat because he was intoxicated.
I would drive like at midnight.
I drive a yacht.
Or I could do that. Just drive like, how a can you giant crash a yacht? Yacht.
But okay, here's my question: why is this appealing to you?
It just seems like the most fun thing. Imagine just driving your boat wasted and singing blues.
That's so random. I think I would much rather do that sober because it would still be fun and I wouldn't be endangering myself or other people.
No.
That's like giant cargo ships. You destroy anything that you hit with those. It'd be hard to crash yourself.
I would try to wear a life jacket, but with how like drunk I'd be, I'd probably wear like floaties or something.
Yeah. Those work too.
This is not a good idea. I hope you never try to do this. It's just as dangerous as driving a car while you're drunk, which is a horrible, horrible, horrible
really?
Idea. Yes.
I mean, like, how many other people will I encounter?
I don't know.
You mean by
yourself? I guess it depends where you are.
Huh.
I mean, you could drive while drunk with nobody around if you went to, like, the middle of a cornfield or something, I guess. Like. But as long as you're in an area
that's kind of dangerous because I can't see anything.
You think you can see anything out in the middle of the ocean at night?
Maybe.
I don't know. I think it's a really bad idea. Don't ever do this. All right, moving on. My number four, I put peeing in public or outdoors.
Oh, come on. It's my number one.
Is it really?
Yes.
There's no way this is a crime.
You can't pee in public. Like, you know, it's indecent exposure or something like that, or lewd activity. And it's one of the simpler joys in life. It's something that's easier for guys to do, but it's kind of harmless and it makes me happy. I even put in my notes, I know Jet loves this too. You would rather go pee in our backyard than walk to your bathroom, even if it's right there.
Yeah. Sometimes when the dog go outside, I also go outside.
Hey, Jake, wanna go outside?
I don't know why. It's just kind of freeing, something that's fun to do. I wouldn't do it like in a place where people would frequent because then it's going to be dirty and smell gross. But like if I'm out in the wilderness or something, it's fun.
Well, then that's not a crime if no one's going to see.
It's a good change up from being in the bathroom.
Yeah, yeah. But it's something that's pretty harmless for the most part. So and it's fun. One of the simpler joys in life. So I had it as my number four.
I would do it like in a grocery store, but like near the dog food section.
I want to pee off a mountain.
Like in the store?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's why it's your number one and it's my number four.
Or in a cup, and then put the cup like behind dog food.
You have always been like that. Why the dog food section?
Because they're going to smell like, oh, this dog food smells weird. You're not going to... Or maybe they thought...
Man, this milk has gone bad.
This is like the most random Jet episode so far. Or, like everything you've said so far.
I pee on the floor. And then I bring my dog into the store like, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry. My dog just peed on the floor.
Even when we're in the car, you'll be like, well, on a road trip or something, you're like, I really need to pee. And I'm like, okay, well, we'll stop somewhere as soon as I find a gas station or something. You're like, no, just give me a bottle. I'm like, no, I'm not going to give you a bottle. Just wait till we get to. You're like, no, I would rather pee in a bottle.
Also, like when you pee outside, you have like free aim.
True. Like, you don't have to target when you go
to your bathroom, but yeah. You can do whatever you want.
I still miss sometimes.
Miss what?
There's nothing.
I get some on me.
Oh.
Because have you ever like started peeing before you get the whole thing out? So you pee a little bit in your pants and then you immediately get it out.
No. There are some times when I think I'm done and I put it up and then I feel a couple drops come out. I'm like, oh, gross.
I hate to walk with that.
No, I always shake after.
Like. I do too, but I think I figured out the secret. This is getting a little bit too personal on here, or TMI. Sometimes if you pull it out and like, how do I say this without being lewd? Your underwear kind of like blocks the circulation a little bit. You know what I mean? If you don't take it like all the way out.
Yeah, yeah.
And then when you put it back in, the circulation is in unrestricted.
It clears up the pipes. And then
a little bit more comes out. Yeah. So I'm super careful about that now. And it took me like 25 years to figure this out.
I've just been peeing my pants all my life after I'm done.
Yeah. It's not a good feeling. All right. So my number four, what did I say it was? Peeing in public. All right, let's move on. Cade, what is your...
Number three.
Arson.
Burning a building down. Okay.
Yeah, like, who doesn't love playing with fire? I mean, come on. Fire is like the most fun thing to play with.
Yeah.
Right?
Which building would you burn down?
And like making campfires is fun. Like flicking lighters is fun. Imagine starting a huge fire. Like A huge, huge fire.
Yeah.
That sounds really fun.
Would you pick like an abandoned building somewhere?
Yeah. It's something where it's not going to cost someone a lot of money. Because that's probably going to suck.
Sure.
Or if it's someone I don't like.
What if you're rich and you burn a building down, but then you give them like double how much it costs to build?
It's still a crime. You still go to jail.
And let's say you own some property, right?
Uh-huh.
And then you burn it down. And then you tell, you know...
Insurance fraud.
Yeah, just to say that
we're back to Jets number five.
Just say that I didn't do this. Like, this is crazy. Like,
there was a house in my neighborhood that I grew up in that burned down, I want to say twice. And and they were under... The rumor was, I don't know, I never researched it, but the rumor was they were under investigation for arson of their own place because people thought they were doing it to like get money to remodel their home.
Yeah, you get a lot of money for that. It's like own like a store or something. You burn down the store. That's always been a
fear of mine, is that I would come home one day and my house would be burned down, just because there's a lot of like, I'm a sentimental guy. I put a lot of sentimental attachment in some things, you know, and I would hate to lose like those things. Not, I don't care about the TVs and the computers and that, but like my backup hard drives that have pictures of you guys from your you know, youth and when you were babies. If I lost those, I would be so heartbroken. I used to keep hard drives at work, backup hard drives at work, in case one day I came home and my house was burned down, because then I had those pictures stored. I can't do that anymore because I work in a high security place and you can't bring in hard drives there. So I don't know what I'm going to do now. I need like locations where I can store hard drives to keep
bury them.
Yeah. Anyway. All right. So arson's your number three.
Yep.
Anything else to add about that?
I like playing with fire.
True.
Number three is being nude in public.
Okay.
Jet has the best list so far.
Yeah, definitely the most random.
Like, a lot of times, like, I'm just tired of constantly getting dressed and undressed. So, like...
You do take forever to get dressed.
True. I just not dress.
And then go out in public.
Yeah. And I think people would be too uncomfortable to even, like, say anything about it.
Somebody would say something.
If they're like, hey, dude, you're nude. I'd be like, I didn't know that.
And? Your point?
So recently, we were outside and, we were walking in the front and you were barefoot and it was in the morning and there was still dew on the grass. And as a joke, I like bumped your shoulder and pushed you into the grass.
And you
had to get your feet all wet. And you were like, why'd you do that? I'm like, because the grass is wet and I'm a bully. And we walked inside and you're like, I can't believe you did that. And then you did something in retaliation in the kitchen. I'm like, you shouldn't have done that because now I'm going to take your pants off. I'm going to take you outside and put your butt on the grass. You're like, you're not going to do it. So then I tricked you into coming into the garage and you did. And then I stood in the way so you couldn't get back inside without getting past me. And I picked you up and I pulled your pants down and I threw your bare butt in the grass.
I put up a good fight.
You did.
And then you tripped me and then like you like implanted me in the ground.
Yeah, that was fun.
It felt kind of like refreshing though.
And then you stayed there for a long time and I'm like, dude, the neighbors are gonna see you, and you weren't like in any type of hurry to get up because I guess you have always wanted to be nude in public apparently. So then I started to close the garage and you had to like dive in while your pants were still pulled down. That was fun. All right, anything else to add about being nude in public?
No.
All right,
well, I'd shave first.
Jet has hit puberty. All right, number three for me. This is, I put breaking into like a place that people aren't allowed to go. The public isn't allowed to go. And I had.
That's a really good one.
I had a few examples. Area 51 was the first one to come to mind.
Pentagon.
I didn't put the Pentagon. I almost didn't put Area 51 because of that whole social media thing that happened last year about breaking into Area 51. I thought it was kind of silly. But I want to know what's in there. Is it aliens? Is it...
I mean, why are they hiding it from us?
Yeah.
Like, it's obviously something, like, they don't want us to know.
Is it a warehouse of really cool artifacts, like in Indiana Jones, right? I want to know what's
the
in
Ark
there.
Is in there.
Yeah.
The Ark, an alien corpse.
Right. But really, I think I'd rather break into the Vatican archives. Have you heard about this?
Yeah.
It's 52 miles of the oldest pieces of paper in the world buried in a library below Vatican City. Historical documents, books, and letters. I would love to go through that stuff. And another interesting one I found, there's an island called Poveglia Island. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly, but that's how it's spelled. It's in Italy. And it was once used as a mental hospital a long time ago. So there's all sorts of like ghost stories that go on about this island. And then on top of that, it was used to quarantine victims during the Black Death, bubonic plague. Whoa. So like 160,000 people that were sick were sent there and died. And also Napoleon used it to store weapons. And now, now it's closed off to the public. But I think that would be so cool to explore there.
Yeah. And it's funny how you said the Vatican right after Area 51, because after the meme died for Area 51, it was, hey, let's storm the Vatican.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Did you not see that?
No, it's I never saw
Area 51 failed. Let's storm the Vatican.
No, I didn't even know that. That's cool, though. All right. So that's my number three. Hey, Cade, what is your
number two?
Money laundering.
Okay.
I thought about this.
We recently watched the Shawshank Redemption.
Uh-huh.
Spoiler alert.
Yeah.
Money laundering isn't involved.
It's been out since 94. I think we can spoil it.
That's true.
Great movie, though. If you haven't seen it, go watch it.
Yeah. But, yeah, I mean, it, when you, in theory, it sounds foolproof, just like communism. But, like, in practice, obviously, people, it doesn't work all, most
people
of the time.
People get caught,
yeah,
sure.
People get caught all the time, but it sounds like a pretty cool way to make money.
You should watch Ozark.
Ozark?
Mm-hmm. A ton of people are watching it right now because season 3 came out. I've watched seasons 1 and 2. It's about money laundering, and it's really good. I haven't watched season 3. I don't know if I'm going to because I don't really remember what happened in season 2. It's been a long time since I watched it. But if you liked the idea of money laundering, and it's a really good show that is binge-worthy.
Is it like a tutorial?
No, but it's really good. You should watch it.
Okay. Yeah.
After you watch Patriot.
Let me finish my shows right now.
It'll never happen. All right. So money laundering is your number. What was that? Number two?
Two. Right. Yeah.
Jet, what's your
shoplifting.
Number two? Shoplifting. What would you take?
Well, I thought about this. You remember those Stompies?
Yeah. Like those sandals that you would wear, yes. Like slippers. And then when you pushed it
I
down.
I could hide a lot of stuff, like a lot of small candies and stuff in there. I'd wear a long sleeve t-shirt. And I'd put toothbrushes in the sleeve and walk like this.
You would shoplift toothbrushes?
I could put a lot of stuff in my pants, too.
Why don't you wear, like big baggy jeans and a jacket or something?
I won't be too obvious. I'd
right.
put a
little... Yeah. Stompies. For our listeners, stompies are these slippers that you put on that little kids would wear. And when you would step down, the mouth would open. Like, it'd be like but an animal, like an alligator.
Mine was broken, so, like... I could just open up the little flap, put something in there, and
but
close
that
it
little
back
flap
up.
Doesn't like seal.
No, but mine was broken; like it didn't go up.
It would not work at all.
No,
why don't you buy the shoes I have, or the shoes my dad is trying to get that have hidden pockets on the side of them?
That would be way better than Stompies.
Yeah, like you can't even see that there's pockets on these.
Someone is wearing Stompies. What do you think, dude? That guy's doing.
If they
something.
Bent over and put things inside their stompies, yes, I would think that guy's shoplifting.
And you would attract a lot of attention wearing stompies. I mean, that's just.
And it's not secure, so it would probably fall out.
I don't know, man.
You need a better plan. And all those toothbrushes that you're stealing, I don't know what you're gonna do with them. You don't even brush your teeth that often. So
No, he's buying them for the candy he's stealing because he knows it's going to be bad
okay,
once
so you
he
steal
gets
the candy,
a large amount of candy.
I brush my teeth. Cereal, I don't know how to steal that. Maybe fit them in my stompies.
All right. didn't Kevin McAllister steal a toothbrush?
But like on accident.
On accident,
right?
But he said, I'm a criminal.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Because, like, the criminals were...
This is from Home Alone, for those who don't know who Kevin McAllister is.
That's in Home Alone
1.
Yeah.
It's the first one. All right. Is that it for your number two?
Yeah.
I'm going to play a clue for my number two and see if you guys can guess it, okay? You got to put your headphones back on for this. Then you can take them off. Are you ready?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Ferris Bueller.
Yes. Okay, but Ferris Bueller is not a crime.
Skipping school?
No.
Skipping work?
No.
Going on stage?
No.
Oh, car?
No. Okay, I'll give you another clue. Same actor, same decade.
War Games.
Oh,
did something.
Changes grades.
Yes, but what is that?
Hack.
Hacking. You got it. Good job. I knew we'd get there eventually. So my number two crime is hacking. Obviously, Ferris Bueller and Matthew Broderick, and in War Games, he changed his absences.
Yeah,
he like hacked into the
in
school
War
system.
Games. He changed his
War
grades.
Games. He changed his grades. Yeah,
the principal is like watching it go
yeah.
down.
He's it like drops from 9 times, and then it drops all the way down to like 2. So hacking has been like romanticized in movies. Also, The Matrix, Hacker, Sneaker, Swordfish, The Net. There's a TV show called Mr. Robot. It's about hacking, and there are countless heist movies where hacking is like part of the plot, something they have to do to like achieve their goal.
I feel like it's an excuse to like not write something a lot of the times.
Oh yeah, like how are we gonna do that? We'll just hack the system, right?
There's no way of getting through that door. Oh wait, I got it.
Yeah, I know
the person.
Let me take this panel off the door and like plug in these little clips to these wires and type this something into my machine
and say
here.
Some random big words that no one understands. And then the big group guy's like, "Hey, Four Eyes, when are we gonna get in?" Yeah. It's like every movie,
like Die Hard. Yeah, right? That's exactly what it is. But I like the idea of it. It's cool. Yeah. And I don't even know what I would hack or what I would do. Maybe send a message or steal money or rig a contest. Someone actually did that in the 90s. They rigged a contest by hacking in and blocking phone calls so they could win a Porsche.
That's really smart.
It's kind of cool. Actually, you know what I'd do? I'd probably erase all my debt. You know, that would be something that would really benefit me. And I don't know. Anyway, hacking is my number two. And thank you, Ferris Bueller.
Have you seen G-Force?
No.
The movie with hamsters? And they're like,
I know what movie you're talking about.
That movie's amazing.
Best movie of all time. They do hacking stuff in that.
All right. That leads us to Cade. What is your
number one?
Drug manufacturing and cultivation.
Oh, this is because you're watching Narcos.
It is.
Okay. So explain why this is your number one, aside from that you're watching Narcos.
Apart from all the bad stuff that happens in Narcos.
All the surrounding crimes that go along with this.
Yeah.
Like murder.
Yeah, like that. Yeah. Like kids died and stuff like that. I also watched Blow.
Yeah. You talked about this last episode.
Is related, yeah. Mm-hmm. So, like, the part where they're having fun when it's going good sounds like a really good time.
Yeah.
They're just buying stupid stuff and doing whatever they want with it.
Sure.
And it sounds like it was definitely a lot easier to do, I feel like, in the 80s than it is now.
Yeah. I have a question for you, though, because, okay, obviously this is inspired by Narcos because you've been watching it.
Yeah.
But the reasoning that you're saying here is because they were making a ton of money, you could do whatever they wanted. Why not pick a crime then that could make you a ton of money that doesn't like get people addicted to drugs? Like you could counterfeit money.
That's so boring.
I didn't include it because it's boring too, but it's on my honorable mention.
So boring.
Okay, so this is to keep it interesting.
Yeah, it's
and ignoring the side effects of distributing illegal drugs.
Yeah, and like always being on the run, but having like a lot of money and doing it. It sounds like a cool lifestyle.
There's like, I guess there's some romanticism that goes along with it because, like, what's the guy's name? I'm drawing a blank. The guy that Narcos is about.
Pablo Escobar.
He's like a king in some sense. Like he's like the king.
They call him the king of coke.
Is he a genius?
Yeah.
I don't know if he's a genius. He made business decisions.
He was a really good negotiator, I guess you could say.
But he's like the kingdom of his own empire.
Yeah.
And so there's like some romanticism with that aspect.
Yeah, I don't think it would work in America. A lot of Pablo Escobar's like shenanigans that he got away with was bribing the government.
Yeah.
He built his own prison.
Yeah.
He surrendered himself, built his own prison, so they wouldn't extract him and put him in a U.S. prison.
Yeah.
So like, I wouldn't stay in the U.S. I don't know where I'd go. Probably Canada or something like that.
Canada would be a great place to live. But I don't think the government is as corrupt there as the other countries.
But, like, I wouldn't do coke, personally. Because, like, I don't know. I mean, it's coke. It's bad for people.
Yeah.
Like marijuana, I guess. It's a very common one.
For the purpose of this list, we could ignore the other side effects, right? Like, I understand the appeal of what you're saying.
Yeah.
We don't have to think about, like, kids on the streets doing cocaine or whatever as a side effect of your choice here.
That's true. But like otherwise it seems, I don't know.
Yeah.
It seems like the most fun one to do out of all of them.
I get it. And it's, I mean, you have been watching Narcos and been talking about it a lot.
And you get to be like notorious.
Yeah.
Like, that's pretty awesome. You're
like infamous basically. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like imagine that everyone that looked at you was like, holy crap, I'm not messing with that guy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Although
it also puts a target on your back.
That's true. But that kind of lifestyle seems fun. Like always running. But
always,
like,
yeah.
Always being in control at the same time.
Cool. All right, that's a good choice. All right, Jet, what's your number one?
Urinating in public.
Being in public. Anything else to add besides what we already said?
No.
Okay. My number one is like the most innocent crime you can think of. It's probably a really boring choice for number one, but I chose spending a whole day in the theater.
What?
Crime? I guess I'm not really all that devious, but I love this idea. And I did it in my youth once or twice where you pay once to go see a movie.
Yeah, and you just hop theaters.
And then you sneak into another theater.
Wouldn't that be like really easy to get away with?
It is really easy to get away with.
Probably.
Like how would anyone catch you?
You don't get caught.
If somebody was paying attention or like I have a big red beard and so I kind of stand out. If the same employee saw me going from theater to theater, they'd be like, That dude, you should, he didn't
keep changing like disguises.
No, that's what I was supposed to say. That when I did it, me and my friend wore hoods,
yeah,
and then jackets. And then after we'd watch the movie, take the hood down, watch the next movie, take the jacket off, watch the next movie. That's three movies,
yeah,
in three different outfits. I mean,
yeah. I mean, I picked the. It's harmless. I wouldn't have to harbor any guilt, and it's fun. I love going to the theater. The hard part would be loading up on enough snacks to last me the whole day, because I wouldn't want to risk
jackets.
True, but I wouldn't want to risk going out to the concession,
yeah,
and then having to come back in with it without a valid ticket stub, unless they had the concession open past the gate where I could go there. But yeah, I love going to the theater, so that's my number one.
Yeah, we had also we took the cups out of the trash cans, removed the lids and the straws, and got free drinks.
Nice.
I think we did that with popcorn too, actually.
Really?
Yeah. So you don't have to pay for a drink. Because you know how much popcorn is? It's like $8 for a thing of popcorn.
I know.
And like a drink is like $6.
For us to go to the theater, it's like $100 for the tickets and the drinks and the popcorn. And
it's so easy just to sneak stuff in, go to the racetrack like 10 minutes before and then just go. It's like.
I know. But we go all out when we do like opening night movies, like for Star Wars. That's true. Yeah. I'd rather go to the theater, get the popcorn there, get the candy there, like have the whole theater experience. It's worth the $100 is worth the experience for that. Yeah. But on any given day, we're like, hey, let's go catch a movie. We're watching, see what's out there.
Avengers or something. Yeah. I don't want
to.
Like,
I wouldn't go out. Then we're going to the gas station. We're going to load our pockets up with whatever we can fit. And and we still get popcorn. We always get popcorn.
Movie theater popcorn's like it's better when you get it fresh, like right there.
It's unbeatable. I agree. All right, Kay, do you have any
honorable mention?
I did have Indecent Exposure on
like,
there.
Like Jets.
I want to be a streaker though. Like at like a baseball game or something.
Okay, and like get on the field.
That'd be really fun.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, getting on the field at all seems kind of fun.
Yeah. My friend Lane, he did never do this, but when we were freshmen at UT, he wanted to streak across campus. And he wanted me to like drop him off and then drive to the other side and pick him up.
Yeah, let me.
When me and Dad were at a game, we like experienced a streaker.
Yeah, we did. That's
right. That was so awesome.
We were at but he wasn't naked.
Yeah. He was super fast, but he tripped, and that was it.
He was also super drunk. Do you remember? He was running, and he was holding his beer in one hand, and he was trying not to spill it, and he fell, and he kept his beer upright. And then he got back up and started running and got tackled.
But like
he was right next to us, too, because we were at a game, and it was getting late, and it was a blowout. The Rangers won big. So we moved, and we came all the way down, and we sat in the front row by third base.
Which is awesome.
For, like, the last inning, basically. And there was a guy, like, three seats from us who just hopped over the wall.
And, like, a lot of times the security guards are, like, big dudes. Yeah. Like, I feel like I can outrun most of them.
Sometimes they do. You know, sometimes they're able to kind of, like, run around for a little while. It's considered a pretty dangerous thing because players are out there, and they're, like, you know, who knows what people's intentions are when they run out. If you're just running around being goofy, that's one thing. But you never know. Because there was an athlete, Monica Seles, tennis player, who got stabbed by somebody who ran out on the court and stabbed her in the back. Somebody who was obsessed with her. Yeah. It ended her career, except she made a comeback later, but she wasn't ever the same.
That's insane.
It's crazy.
I want to go up and give like someone like a fist bump or something. I don't know.
Yeah. I watched this video recently. I can't remember the guy's name. It's going to drive me crazy. A baseball player played for like 19 years, I think, and part of his career was on the Chicago Cubs. And in a game in the 70s, two guys, father and son, actually, the kid was 11 years old and came out with his father, and they tried to burn an American flag in the outfield. Like they carried it on the field. They lit it with, or they soaked it in that, and they were trying to light it, and his matches kept going out. And Rick Monday, I think is the guy's name, the outfielder. He ran up behind them, snatched up the flag just as the match was about to touch it, and picked it up and carried it off the field and handed it to the other team.
And then beat up the kid.
No, they didn't do that. Then the security came out and they got the guys. And I don't know, the guy, like he played 19 years and he's really only known for doing that, which you think, oh, that's kind of sad. But he's actually really proud of it. He's like, it's not such a bad thing to be known for.
Yeah.
It's just a cool story.
Yeah,
if that dude didn't trip while we were at the game, like, he was pretty fast. Like when he first ran, he was really fast.
Yeah. He should have worn cleats to the game.
But like, if he didn't trip, he would go on for a little long while.
I'm gonna do it one time in my life. Run out on the field.
Yeah, you'll spend the night in jail. I mean,
I don't care.
Is that the only like punishment?
I don't know. I don't.
Someone would have to bail you out, right?
Yeah, I don't know if they press charges. There's probably a fine associated.
I'll start a GoFundMe before, like, hey, I'm gonna run out on a field and I need money for my bail after I get arrested.
I don't know like how serious the repercussions are. Like, I know for example, I would lose my job for sure. My job requires a certain level of clearance that. Mm-hmm. That if I got arrested, that would be revoked, right? And I don't know if that goes for like other jobs also. Like you have something on your record, you go apply for a job, you have to disclose it. You know, it's not like It's not like it doesn't have repercussions.
I know.
Maybe it's a minor thing. Maybe it's not like...
I really wish it was just like, okay, you get kicked out of the game. Like,
right. Or like you get a ticket or something. Yeah. Like, but if it goes on your record...
If that was the case, then like,
I wouldn't do it.
Like
I think a lot of people would do it then.
Yeah. I'm going to do some research into this.
What if like...
If it's like you get kicked out of the game or something like that, or you get suspended for like 4 games or something. I don't know.
Imagine if like 50 people ran on it. Like 50 people just started running on the field.
So I have rushed a field before.
Really?
People do this like when especially in college, if a college team wins a game that's an upset over another team that you weren't expecting to win, a lot of times fans rush onto the field. And I did this once when I was in Arizona.
Did a lot of other people do it too? So it was no problem.
It wasn't a big deal. They climb up on the field goal post. They try to bring them down. I didn't do that. We did have kids that were trying to do that and they weren't able to pull it down, which is kind of embarrassing. But when I was at Arizona, we beat UCLA. They were ranked number 3 in the country at the time. It was a big upset. And we all rushed the field afterwards. It was super fun. The only bad part was the casualty of my favorite flip-flops because somebody stepped on it and it broke it. And I was like, oh, I love these.
You were wearing flip-flops? I thought you hated wearing flip-flops. Like
I do now. I wore them a lot in college. And I went to college in Arizona. Like everybody wears flip-flops in Arizona because it's like 120 degrees all the time. But
is it hotter than Texas?
Yeah. Dang. Although it doesn't feel like it. Texas feels hotter because of the humidity.
Maybe you're just used to it being in Arizona.
Arizona has, it's hotter, but it's not as gross humid. And then at night, it cools down quite a bit, whereas in Texas, it just stays hot in the night also. All right. Anyways, any other honorable mentions, Cade?
No.
Jet?
No.
I had robbing a casino as an honorable mention because tons of money. And there's Ocean's 11, which is fun. Like, it kind of goes without robbing something super valuable or like a piece of art where you have to like have an intricate plan to make it work. That's interesting to me. Counterfeiting money, obviously you get tons of money. I had speeding, very minor crime.
I
do it all the time. I'm like a very aggressive
driver. Street racing?
I don't really care about that, but I like to drive fast. Ripping the tag off of a mattress.
That's a crime?
It says it on the mattress tags. It's a federal offense. Sneaking into a baseball game is kind of like the theater thing. And squatting, like in a house that doesn't belong.
Is putting gum underneath desk a crime?
No, I don't think so.
Damaging school vandalism.
All right, that concludes my honorable mentions. We should probably move on to
the worst.
What you got for your worst, Cade?
I mean, obviously murder. It's like the worst thing you can do. I mean, there's no, like, I don't understand how anyone is okay doing that to anyone, like, no matter who they are.
Yeah.
What if, like, you murder someone who's, like, a murderer?
I don't think I could bring myself to kill anyone.
Same.
It's just, no matter what they've done.
I see what you're saying, Jet. Like, if somebody killed Adolf Hitler.
Like, someone killed your son. Like.
Oh, and you.
You probably couldn't, like, help it.
There'd be, I agree. And if you're, I don't know. It's still ending somebody's life, you know? It's not a.
And it's still going to affect someone else. Like, I think that's the biggest thing for me.
I don't know if I have it in me. I don't think. I think if I was in the moment and I had to, to protect myself or my family,
I would say then
that's not really murder. That's self defense. But that's the only scenario I could imagine myself being able to like take another life.
Yeah,
I don't know. But I mean, we watched a movie recently,
Minority Report,
where Tom Cruise's character is confronted with who he thinks kidnapped his son years ago,
and he's like so close to.
And he's so close to like in that situation, it might be hard. I don't know.
And that guy who like he was trying to kill who didn't actually kill his son.
Yeah,
that's a good guy. Like,
yeah, because he wasn't really.
And
the
he wanted Tom Cruise to like kill him for
right the because good. It was to help his family.
So
right.
so that guy at first like you were like rooting for Tom Cruise, you know?
Yeah.
And then like you're like you feel bad for that guy.
Yeah,
I feel like there'd be like some serious like repercussions and like guilt after, no matter who it is.
Sure.
I mean, like. Guys in the military, you know? I mean, people die all the time in places, like, all over the world. And, like, if I knew, like, I love all of you guys so much, and, like, knowing, like, what you guys would feel like if I got, like, if I died or something like that, like, I can't imagine causing that to someone else's family.
I know.
That just seems like horrible.
And everybody feels like they're on the right side, you know? And I recently talked to somebody about this. I think that soldiers, they have to almost have to shut that part off.
Yeah.
You have to look at it as they're not
doing the greater thing.
You're not fighting
saving other lives.
Yeah. But it's, I mean, and we talked about this when we watched 1917, when they spared that guy's life. I mean, that guy that they spared, who ended up costing him his own life, right? But he has a family too. He has a mother and maybe a wife and maybe kids and whatever. And it's not, I don't know.
If you saw someone in the situation and they were like the so-called enemy, but like, and they didn't seem like they could do any harm to you. I mean, like, it'd be like almost inhumane not to do something to help them.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah. It just seems wrong no matter what you do.
I agree. All right, Jack, what's your worst?
Sexual assault.
Yeah, that's a really bad one. Yeah.
I feel like just like it's more scarring than like anything.
I put the same, a rape, because any crime that directly hurts people is something I wouldn't do, but there's a lot to choose from. But I think that is probably the most like violating. And murder, obviously,
and, like,
is horrible.
I don't know, like, a single person, like, well, I don't know anyone who's actually been sexually assaulted, but, like, if I did, like, that would leave a huge scar on them.
Yeah, yeah, it's horrible. I agree. All right, so we're all kind of on the same page there.
Yeah.
All right, let's move on to... Listener choices.
I'm excited for this one. I want to know what people say.
Well, okay, so I've decided not to share stories because I don't want to incriminate anybody. But there were some interesting stories. I asked social media, have you ever shoplifted? I will say the results were overwhelmingly yes.
Yeah, I feel like everyone has.
The ratio, when I added them all up, was 7-1. 7 times the amount of people said yes than compared to who said no. And there were some pretty interesting stories on there. But yeah, so according to our listeners, shoplifting is a thing to do. But I will say a lot of people said that there was a recurring theme. Yeah, when I was younger, I did this and that. I'm not super proud of it. But like kind of like you said, there was like a thrill associated with it. I mean, I shoplifted when I was younger. I'm not proud of it either. And it was easier to get away with back then.
That's what I'm saying. Than it is now. I have not shoplifted, even though several times I have wanted to.
There's a lot more security now.
It doesn't seem
now.
Like you can get away with it. Like, I don't see how people can get away with it nowadays.
There's a lot more security now than there was back in the day.
And like I know so many people that shoplift,
yeah.
Like, regularly. It just makes no sense to me how someone doesn't notice.
Well, and this is what I told you when we talked about it before. You go and you take something that's worth $20 or $50 or $100 or whatever, and you feel like you're, you know, I'm getting something for free. But there is a chance, and in some places, a good chance that you'll get caught. And it's just not worth the risk.
Yeah.
Because if you get caught, the repercussions are severe. They're really severe. And was it really worth getting? I mean, in my youth, it was CDs. You know, we stole CDs from music stores or clothes or whatever. A lot of girls on my poll put, like, they stole, like, earrings and stuff and jewelry and makeup. And I'm
A lot of my friends that are girls, they always steal from, like, Forever 21.
Right.
I'm like, okay, well, that store's a mess. Like, you can take anything you want.
True.
But, like...
But it's just not... And this is what I tell you. It's just not worth the risk. Because if you do get caught... For like taking something that was $20, was it worth it to get severely punished for something that was $20? Listen, if you really wanted that bad, let me know, and we'll work something out. You know, it's just not worth it. So, anyways, let's move on to the
pew.
Glenn Solomon fun fact of the week.
Pew.
Good.
So this episode's already long because we've been telling a lot of stories, which is fun, and the fun fact is really long. So I'm gonna try to condense it here. It's about a criminal named Cowboy Bob, and it's a fascinating story. And although it's a little long, it's well worth to listen. So back in the 90s, 1991, 1992, there was a mysterious 10-gallon hat-wearing robber. You know what a 10-gallon hat is? Like the big, big, big cowboy hats.
Yeah.
Dude with a beard. He was pulling off large-scale bank robberies with like flawless execution. You know, he was doing everything right. His name was Cowboy Bob because of his hat. He was always calm. He was unarmed. And he was polite, and he was silent. Yet he robbed all these banks.
Sounds like a movie character.
Yeah.
I think I know who this is.
Well, listen, because this is so interesting, okay? He would steer clear of security cameras. There were a few images that were caught of him, but you couldn't really see him because he's wearing this big 10-gallon hat. He would check each bill for those dye packs that they put in there, and he just did everything perfect. And when he was done, he would casually exit the bank. He'd place a new, he did it under 60 seconds every time. He would go to a car that had a new license plate on it every time, a stolen license plate. It was a 1975 Pontiac Grand Prix, drive off into the sunset and could not get caught. And authorities were after him for a year. He did this, like, and didn't hide it. Like, he just went and did it and got away with it every time. And so there was a cop who was after him. His name was Powell, Steve Powell. This happened in Texas, by the way. And he,
no wonder.
Yeah, Callahan. I know. So this cop said he was making me start to pull my hair out. How could this thin little dried up cowboy be whipping us this bad time after time? They didn't have any leads, so they would try to place Tracy's license plate numbers, hoping that one of them would turn up. One time it finally did. Whether it was out of cockiness or carelessness or whatever, Cowboy Bob forgot to replace his real license plate. And one of the bank tellers saw it, reported it to the police, and they traced it to this guy named Pete Tallis, and he lived in Dallas. And they go to Pete Tallis, and they find out that he never actually owned this car. He was a car dealer. I'm like, oh, man.
Oh, wow.
What are we going to do now? Well, they found out that that car was actually owned by Pete Tallis's sister, whose name was Peggy Jo Tallis. He had given it to her as a gift. So now the FBI agents were like, okay, finally, we have a lead. Let's go talk to this Peggy Jo Tallis. It's probably her boyfriend or something. We'll go figure it out. So they go to Peggy Jo Tallis. They go to her house, and they walk in there, and there's no dude there. It's her and her mom, who is really sick. And there's no boyfriend, and Peggy Jo Tallis is like, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know of any bank robberies. She's like a middle-aged woman, you know. And her story was backed up by family members. She has no boyfriend, has no time for a boyfriend. She spends all of her time taking care of her sick mother. And she would never be mixed up in something criminal like robbing banks. So they left there feeling, or they were about to leave there feeling kind of like, well, what do we do now? However, the police officer Powell noticed as he was leaving that clinging to Peggy Jo's upper lip, there was a thin line of glue and there were little flecks of gray dye on her lip. And suddenly it all came crashing down. She was telling the truth that she didn't have a boyfriend, but she was lying because she was Cowboy Bob. This girl named Peggy Jo Tallis. It all started when her mother got sick. She started, the bills were piling up, and she had been like a young, carefree, you know, spirited young woman. But when she became a full-time caregiver for her mom, she kind of lost all that and fell into this world of robbing banks. So she was convicted of her crimes as a bank robber, and she was sent to prison. She spent a couple years there, and she ended up getting out eventually. And she actually had like a really nice life after that. Her mom had passed away. She went and got a job at a marina where she became like a local favorite, and parents would bring their kids there because she gave them a lot of attention. And she kind of became like a folk hero, you know, that she'd done this and so flawlessly and gotten away with it all this time. And she became like famous in her little town, you know, and it kind of like eclipsed her history of being a bank robber. However, in 2004, her bank robbing ways came back. She decided, I'm going to do one final one, and I'm going to go to Mexico and live off of the money I steal from this bank. But she wasn't as careful as she had been in her other robberies. So, and maybe because she had gotten older, she just wasn't as like crisp as she had been before. She didn't disguise herself as Cowboy Bob. She went in as herself. She wore sunglasses and a wide brim sun hat, but she didn't check the bills. And there was a dye pack in them, and it exploded. So she had to like quickly take off, and she went out to this RV and she had parked in the parking lot. The police were alerted, and there was a short chase, and then they cornered her in this neighborhood. So she comes out, and she's armed for the first time. She had never done a bank robbery armed before, and she had a gun. And so the police didn't want to shoot her because they knew who she was. They knew she had never been violent before, even though she had robbed banks in the past. And they didn't know what to do. So they're like negotiating with her. And she's like, you mean to tell me, and she said this, if I come out with a gun and I point it at y'all, you're not going to shoot me. Then the police officer shot her. Four of them fired at one time.
Really?
Yeah. And she died. So after she died, upon further inspection, they realized the gun in her hands was fake. It was a toy gun. She didn't even have a real one on her. Now there was a real one in her RV, but she didn't have it on her. So it was kind of a sad way to end, yeah. You know? And then the police officer who had arrested her the first time, the Powell guy, mm-hmm. when he heard out, found out about his old nemesis, like going out that way, his words were saying, it ain't so, like, he was sad. He was sad it happened.
Dang.
Oh, that's Cowboy Bob.
Why did they shoot the, like?
Because she was saying she was going to shoot them, and she had a gun. It was fake. They didn't know that. They thought maybe she's lost it. And she fired at one of the officers, and they had the chance to take her down before that happened. That would have been.
But why did she have a fake gun?
I don't know. Maybe she wanted to go out that way. Who knows?
She wanted to go. I'm not. Never mind.
Dang.
I don't know. Kind of a crazy story, though, right?
Yeah, that's a cool story. His headphones aren't on.
I know. I need you to have your headphones on when I play that. All right, Jet, what you got for us?
It's time for Jet's Pun of the Week.
I would have a joke, but someone stole it.
Did you come up with that on
Yes.
your own? That's pretty good.
I did like 10 minutes ago. I'm like, oh, wait, I need to think of something.
All right, I'm going to give you a...
Good job.
Yeah, but it's not playing for some reason.
You do an impersonation of it.
Good job.
Good job.
Claps?
I don't have claps either. Why is my good job not working? I don't know. Good job.
Just like you and Mary.
Did you guys... I saw this on Facebook earlier today. I don't know if you heard about this, but someone stole from Walmart a bunch of weight loss pills. Did you hear about this?
No.
The police say the suspects are still at large. That was my backup in case you didn't
That's good.
All right. Well, thanks everybody for taking the time to listen. Blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
And please join us next time on 5-1 for our discussion on... What was it again? He said...
It's a top 5 sports moments.
Sports moments, you got it.
Nice.
Love you. Love you.